This is an ODB Films production. Visit odbfilms.com today.
In Latin, Renovo means to renew, restore, or revive. The show is all about growing in our understanding and practice of faith. Past episodes are available wherever you like to listen to podcasts. I'm Doug Took, the Vice President of Ministry Advancement at ODB Films. And this is a long-awaited show. Like many of our shows, listeners say, hey, you really ought to do this. And I'm excited about it. We're going to talk about St. Maximilian Kolbe, and he's so unbelievable. I was having lunch with my good friend Sean Courtney not too long ago, just an amazing young person, just incredible youth minister, now, you know, IT specialist. And he just said, man, where is that show? You got to do this show, but make sure you read this book first. And he really challenged me, and I was like, man, that is true. This guy rocks my spiritual world. How have I not done a show about this? And for some of you, you have kids named after this guy, for crying out loud. I'm excited to share just kind of the great, just the amazing, the magnitude of his holiness. He's so unbelievable. So we'll start out with just kind of some basic bio stuff on St. Maximilian Kolbe, but I really want to get into how he has this profound ability to just penetrate your spiritual life, and also just invite you to read him because he's so stinking amazing, and I want you to be inspired by his greatness. So first, just a little bit of short bio. Maximilian Kolbe was born in Poland in 1894, and at about the age of 10, he had this vision of the Virgin Mary. She basically offered him a white crown and a red crown, which represented purity and martyrdom. That was kind of his early childhood experience of the Spirit, and he chose both. It was really a foreshadowing of his life to come. In 1910. He joined the conventual Franciscan order. He was sent to study in Rome, where he founded the MI on October 16th, 1917. He was ordained a priest in 1918. So now Father Maximilian, he returned to Poland, and he began this untiring missionary activity, starting a monthly magazine, establishing two evangelization centers dedicated to the Immaculate Virgin. Niepokalanow, the city of the Immaculata in Poland, and Mugenzai no Sono in Japan, and envisioned these missionary centers all over the world. That was really part of his core. So to better win the world for Christ through the Immaculata, the friars utilized the most modern techniques possible. This is one of the great gifts that St. Maximilian gives to us. He used shortwave radio, and he planned to build a motion picture studio. I love that, being an employee, a worker in ODB Films, that there was this profound need to use any means necessary to evangelize at a really young age, which is super exciting. In 1939, during World War II, at Niepokalanow, I know I'm saying that wrong, he welcomed thousands of refugees, especially Jews. In 1941, St. Maximilian was arrested by the Nazis, and he was taken to the Auschwitz concentration camp. A lot of you know this part of his story. It's amazing. There's so much more to him than that, but it's good to chat about that part of his life too. There, he offered his life for another prisoner and was condemned to slow death in a starvation bunker. He died on August 14th, 1941, with an injection of carbolic acid. Yuck. Pope now, St. John Paul II, canonized him as a saint and martyr of charity on October 10th, 1982. So St. Maximilian Kolbe is considered a patron of journalists, families, prisoners, the pro-life movement, the chemically addicted, and those with eating disorders, which is just kind of amazing. And it's something to remember. Maximilian Kolbe was a groundbreaking theologian. This is something that people don't really give him a lot of credit for. It's why we got to read his stuff more. His insights on the Immaculate Conception really anticipated the Marian theology of the Second Vatican Council, which is just incredible, and also further developed the church's understanding of Mary's role in God's plan of salvation. He was so dedicated to our Blessed Mother, and we'll talk about that in just a little bit. But his Marian thought, it re-echoes in the Marian teaching of both St. John Paul II and Benedict XVI. He really established a bedrock of their understanding as well. Now, let's talk about his spirituality, because I just think he's unbelievable. There's no saint that is greater that has a greater impact on my spiritual life than St. Maximilian Kolbe. I mean, that's just the bottom line in so many different ways. And this fact is kind of wild. Because early on in my faith, I didn't really resonate with him at all. I thought he looked kind of stern and that he talked too much about the Immaculata, a title for the Blessed Virgin that I just thought was weird. I never really had a relationship with Mary in my spirituality, certainly as a younger man. Yet God works mysteriously, as all of you know. And after reading the writings of St. Maximilian himself, I just fell in love with this guy. I just grew to love. I just love him profoundly. I mean, he just has so much to teach. So now I kind of pore over his words of wisdom again and again. His writings are just truly spiritual education. And I see a lot of my friends. My friend Eric has a son that he named Kolbe. I mean, there's just so much influence from his life. So there's so much more to St. Maximilian than his heroic death in Auschwitz, which was an event that really was the crowning of an incredible life of heroic love for others. But in the wake of his feast day back in August 24th, I started to kind of just jot down notes for this show, and I wanted to share some of the important lessons that I personally have learned, as well as, you know, some of his corresponding quotes, just from this guy, this man of God, in the hope that it'll inspire you, that you'll want to learn more about him. So that's the direction I want to go with the show. So first, about Mary, the mother of Jesus. I mean, let's just be honest. St. Maximilian, he lived and died for the lady whom he loved, the Blessed Virgin Mary. That is one thing about Maximilian you need to know. His love for Mary is unparalleled. Yet, it's kind of impossible to understand his devotion to Mary without understanding what motivated it. So to St. Maximilian, devotion to Mary was logical and necessary if one wanted to follow Christ. Think about that. So after all, our mission as Christians is to become little Christs, formed in the image of Jesus in a greater and greater way throughout our lives. That makes perfect sense. But Maximilian teaches there's no better way to be formed into the image of Christ than to entrust ourselves to the woman who literally formed Christ in her womb, the Blessed Virgin Mary. That's where the seeds of his Marian devotion come from. Now, through her profoundly intimate relationship with the Holy Spirit, remember this, Mary brought forth Jesus Christ, God incarnate into the world. She's the new covenant. She's the delivery system for Jesus, all right? So through her union with the Holy Spirit, this forming of Christ and bringing him into the world continues in you and I. That's the parallel. That's the collaboration we have with Mary. So if we want to truly become like Christ, we need to allow ourselves to be formed in the spiritual womb of Mary by the grace and power of the Holy Spirit into the image of the Son of God. There's no other way. Maximilian, he says this, in her womb, the soul must be regenerated according to the form of Jesus Christ. All right, he continues, through the Immaculate, we can become great saints, and what is more, in an easy way. And then he concludes, with the help of the Immaculate, we are capable of everything, right? What a great place to start. So for you, personally, spiritually, you want to grow, immediately turn yourself to your mother. However you want to do it, through the rosary, through consecration, turn yourself to Mary, because she forms us to be like Christ, to love Christ. You don't put Mary before Christ, okay? But Mary helps form us to be like Christ. This is spiritual maturity at its height, okay? Now, for Kolbe, the essence of holiness is obedience, okay? It is tempting to think that holiness consists in, you know, mysticism or incredible deeds or extended periods of prayer. And there is holiness there, right? But we read the lives of the saints and we think that to be holy, that we got to experience God in some direct and immediate way, or perhaps, you know, found a religious order, or maybe convert thousands in a far-flung jungle. Fine. If you're doing that, more power to you. But this is just really not the case. That's not the origin of holiness. One of the most important lessons that St. Maximilian has taught me is that holiness is nothing more than obedience to the will of God in every circumstance of life. Lord, make me holy now. Make me holy in the next 10 minutes, right? Kolbe says, Christian perfection consists in the union of our will with the will of God. Great line. He continues, not in mortification, not in prayer, not in labor, not in rest, but in obedience is the essence and merit of holiness. Those other things are important, but the essence and merit of holiness for Kolbe is in obedience. Then he says, the essence of the love of God does not lie in affections or in sweet words, but solely in the will. Isn't that a great line? He says, if the soul preserves decisively with its will fixed on holiness and love of God, although it does not experience the least feeling in its heart, let it be wholly convinced that it continually tends with rapid pace forward and ever pushes upward. That's a great line. Okay. He also says, do not forget that holiness consists not in extraordinary actions, but in performing your duties towards God, yourself, and others well. I love it. This is, there's a little Teresa of Lisieux in there. There's that little way is in there. Mother Teresa is in there doing, you know, small things in love, right? They become great actions. I love that language. He also says this. He doesn't say it. He talks about this in a way that I think is profound. Your sins can actually be tools to help you grow in holiness. Now, be careful. I'm not talking about like go sin more so you can be more holy. Here's what I'm saying. One of the truths that I learned from St. Maximilian that's been pretty revolutionary to my spiritual life is that sin can actually help us advance on the road to perfection. Here's what that means. It's because the foundation of all holiness is humility, and nothing humbles us more than coming face to face with our own weakness. And this is not to say that we should sin intentionally. I'm not saying that. But that we should never be discouraged when we do fall. So St. Maximilian, he summarizes this idea in this really famous passage. Here's how it goes. He says, my beloved, may every fall, even if it is serious and habitual sin, always become for us a small step toward a higher degree of perfection. In fact, he continues, the only reason why the Immaculate permits us to fall is to cure us from our self-conceit, from our pride, to make us humble and thus make us docile to the divine graces. He continues, the devil, instead, tries to inject in us discouragement and internal depression in those circumstances, which is, in fact, nothing else than our pride surfacing again. He says, if we knew the depth of our poverty, we would not be at all surprised by our falls, but rather astonished, and we would thank God, after sinning, for not allowing us to fall even deeper and still more frequently. Listen, most of us are guilty of habitual sin. We confess the same damn thing every single time. But here's the reality. Let that habitual sin stand out as a place where you can pivot, where do not let me fall further. Be thankful that you didn't fall further and immediately turn in humbleness towards a redeeming Lord. And Kolbe really believes this, that can be a place where we break those habits of sin. Kolbe also exemplified, just quite frankly, missionary zeal. There's just no other way to put it. He lived with intensity. This guy was intense. There was no lukewarmness or half-heartedness in him. His mission was to liberate as many souls as possible from sin and make them happy by uniting them to God by way of his Immaculate Mother, like we talked about. So he was consumed by this desire and compelled by its urgency. And he inspired the same zeal for the salvation of souls everywhere he went, everybody he encountered. Just amazing. It's not enough to become the Immaculate's within some defined limit, right? In every respect, he teaches us, we must desire to radiate her. Kolbe says, so as to draw to her the souls of all others who are, will be, and might be without restriction, period. Kolbe says, in a word, we are to become hers, more and more ready to sacrifice self entirely for her, to the last drop of blood in the conquest of the whole world and every soul in particular, as soon as possible, as soon as possible, as soon as possible. I love that. So he speaks with urgency. This message needs to happen now. Come on, let's go. We gotta go. We got work to do. I love it. Sometimes we don't speak with urgency in our evangelization, okay? Kolbe also teaches us to love everyone, even your enemies. Obviously, that's the gospel message, but he does it in a way that was profound. And of course, he lived that to the end of his days. So it can be really easy to love only the people that we like. You've heard that before, or really just the people we agree with. Check out social media. That is our world. But it's human nature to do that. And as the Lord says, for if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Do not even the tax collectors do the same, right? Yet selective love is not true Christian love. It doesn't work that way. It's why love your enemies is probably the biggest, most challenging thing in this pilgrimage we call discipleship, right? We are called to love everyone, no matter how morally wicked or distasteful to us it is, right? So St. Maximilian lived this way, and his heart was so large, it embraced the world. And here's how he described the love that we must have. Here it is. This is what he says. We need to love our neighbor, not just because he is pleasant or helpful or rich and influential, or even because he shows us gratitude. These motives are too self-serving, unworthy of Our Lady's knights. He says, genuine love rises above creatures and soars up to God. In him, by him, and through him, it loves all men, both good and wicked, friends and enemies. He continues, to all, it stretches out a hand filled with love. It prays for all, suffers for all, wishes what is best for all, desires happiness for all, because that is what God wants. That is a quote to put on the wall or to put on your mirror in the bathroom when you get ready to go to work every day is, can I love them all? And you can't, by the way. You can't on your own accord. You don't have that ability. But listen to me. I'm telling you, in Christ, you do. And consecrating yourself to Mary, you can. You will. Okay? He talks about being discouraged. He lived in a time where there was a lot of discouragement of the faith. There's a lot of discouragement now. This is why he's so relevant today. So in the Christian life, there's always going to be dark times. They're inevitable. It's going to happen. We become weary. We'll suffer. We're going to feel overwhelmed. Some of you can relate to that right now. Yet, Kolbe teaches us, despite the darkness, which sometimes envelops us, we're reminded to never lose heart. Always be courageous, a gift of the Holy Spirit. Entrust everything to Mary. And this might be a good prayer that you say at night before you go to bed. Mary, it's yours. All of it is yours, right? She's our good mother who is far more capable of helping us than we are of helping ourselves. That's a good place to be. That Kolbe says this. He says, let us let ourselves be led then. Let us not attempt to do more than that which Mary wills or more quickly. Let us let ourselves be carried by her. She will think of everything and take care of all our needs, of the soul and of the body. Let us give every difficulty, every sorrow to her and have confidence that she will take care of it better than we could. Peace then, he says, peace, much peace in an unlimited confidence in her. Isn't that a great line? Okay, he continues with this. He says, above all, never let yourselves be troubled, never be frightened, never fear anything. The Immaculate, in fact, is she perhaps not aware of everything? If this were not the case, it would really be a problem. That's Maximilian saying, can you trust her? Can you trust her? She forms you in the way that you love Jesus, in the way that she loved Jesus, which is the way we're all supposed to love Jesus. And that is fantastic. I love that, especially in this day and age, to not have fear in those spaces. So good, good. Finally, Kolbe, he's a man of our times right now. And I mentioned that a little bit in the show, but we need him now more than ever, right? I could talk about all kinds of, I mean, we could share all kinds of quotes. I don't want to go too long, but like there's so much more. But listen, I got to tell you, I just really encourage you to read St. Maximilian for yourself. His writings are simple, yet deeply profound. And he speaks with a profound a wisdom. That can really, it can only be from the Holy Spirit. And undoubtedly, his words are going to stir for you a greater love for God, his mother, and for all humankind. And I hope that that's something you can do, that you can grow in your love for Jesus in that way. A couple of books, a couple of collections. The Kolbe Reader is great. It's a great collection, easy to get. It's on Amazon. A book that I read that my friend TJ turned me on to, Kolbe and the Commandant. That's an amazing book. It's biographical, is that a word? It's biographical of Kolbe, but also the commandant who ended up sentencing him to death in Auschwitz and how their two lives sort of end up intersecting. Quite a book. And the other my friend Sean turned me on to was A Man for Others, which is probably the most exhaustive biography and so beautiful and so challenging. So check those out. Just remember this. St. Maximilian, he lived in really dark times and he died in a very dark place. Yet, wherever he went, he specifically radiated the light of God's love. And I want you to take that away from this today's show. Like, he brought mercy like a blazing torch to darkness. And for some of us right now, this is a dark time. This is a time when the world needs light, specifically Christian light, right? Kolbe's life teaches us to entrust ourselves to our Living Mother, Mary Immaculate, and through her to bring both our souls and the souls of others to the happiness of a union with God. I hope you're inspired by that, to do that, not just talk about it, but to do it. We can say, may we, like him, illumine the darkness of this world by the same fire of love, right? St. Maximilian Kolbe, pray for us. And so let's call upon him to do that. Let's make that a part of our spiritual lives, especially as we navigate whatever's going on in our lives, work, and just the difficulty of the entire narrative that is our story. Bring that light to dark places through the lens of our Mother Mary. Thanks for listening. Sincerely, we are partners in the journey of faith, and I hope you'll share the Renovo podcast with friends and foes. Send your topic suggestions, questions, and or comments to doug@odbfilms.com. Friends, always remember to engage the tradition and live the conversion. Until next time, God bless.